chapter, which is the Undemocratic Socialists. And we are composed of a group of the Central New Jersey Democratic Socialist Association. My partner Tess will be here in a little bit. She's running a little bit late from class. So I will go ahead and hand out, I made some photocopies of Jacobson, ABCs of Socialism. I think we should have enough for everybody here, but if not, let's share.
Good morning.
Yeah, that'd be great.
I'll also be passing around. This is a pamphlet that we put together, kind of going over what our personal mission is for our White Yes chapter. And yeah, so I think we only have about 15 minutes today, or 15. I'm not sure, 50 I think. So there are quite a couple chapters in Jacobson's ABCs of Socialism, and we won't be able to read them all. So Tess and I went through the book, and we chose a couple sections that we think would be like most popular interest to read, but we can kind of decide what we want to do as a group. So in the packet that you have, there is, yes.
If we move that closer to each other, no?
Yes, like, that would be great,
weird,
actually.
So far.
We are quite
far. And we have a moment.
Yeah. This does our relaxing. These are the ones that we've selected in these printouts, but I think due to time, we might have to
arrange them.
Yeah. So we'll see how we feel. Is there any one that we'll particularly definitely want to read this session? If not, we'll just go ahead and start with the first one. Socialism sounds good in theory, but doesn't human nature make it impossible to realize? Okay, so we're just going to do a roundtable reading. If you could just read a couple paragraphs, or just one paragraph, depending on how you feel. And once you feel like you've read enough, go ahead and the next person will go ahead and read. And you can also choose to pass if you don't want to read out loud. Okay, so would anyone like to start?
I'll start. Good in theory, bad in practice. People who profess interest in socialism and the idea of a society without exploitation and hierarchy are often met with this dismissive reply. Sure, the concept sounds nice, but people aren't very nice, right? Isn't capitalism much more suited to human nature, a nature dominated by competitiveness and venality? Socialists don't believe these truisms. They don't view history as a mere chronicle of cruelty and selfishness. They also see countless acts of empathy, reciprocity, and love. People are complex. They do unspeakable things, but they also engage in remarkable acts of kindness, and even in difficult situations, show deep regard for others.
Okay, this then does not mean that we're plastic. That we're plastic, that there is no such thing as human nature. Progressives do sometimes make this thing, often arguing with those who see people as walking, talking, utility maximizing. Despite its good intention, this approach, it goes too far.
Pass. For at least two reasons, socialists are committed to the view that all humans share some important interests. The first is a moral one. Socialists' indictment of how today's society failed to provide necessities like food and shelter in a world of plenty, or stunt the development of people locked into thankless, grueling, low-paying jobs, rests on a core belief, stated or not, about the impulses and interests that animate people everywhere. Our outrage that individuals are denied the right to live free and full lives is anchored in the idea that people are inherently creative and curious, and that capitalism too often stifles these qualities. Simply put, we strive for a freer and more fulfilling world because everyone, everywhere, cares about the freedom and fulfillment.
But this is not the only reason why socialists are interested in humanity's universal drives. Having a conception of human nature also helps us make sense of the world around us. And by helping us to interpret the world, it aids our efforts to change it as well.
Marx famously said that the history of all hitherto existing society is the history of class struggles. Resistance to exploitation and oppression is a constant throughout history. It is as much a part of human nature as competitiveness or greed. The world around us is filled with instances of people defending their lives and dignity. And while social structures may shape and constrain individual agency, there are no structures that steamroll people's rights and freedoms without inviting resistance.
Of course, the history of all hitherto existing society is also a record of passivity and even acquiescence. Mass collective action against exploitation and oppression is rare. If humans everywhere are committed to defending their individual interests, why don't we resist more? Well, the view that all people have incentives to demand freedom and fulfillment does not imply that they will always have the capacity to do so. Changing the world is no easy feat. Under ordinary circumstances, the risks associated with acting collectively often seem overwhelming. For example, workers who choose to join a union or go on strike to improve their working conditions may invite the scrutiny of their bosses and even lose their jobs.
Collective action requires many different individuals to decide to take these risks together. So it's not surprising that it is uncommon and mostly few. Put differently, socialists don't believe that the absence of mass movements is a sign that people have no inherent desire to fight back, or worse, that they don't even recognize what their interests are. Rather, protest is uncommon because people are smart. They know that in the present political moment, change is a risky, distant hope. So they develop other strategies to get by.
In the past. But sometimes people do step up and take risks. They organize and build progressive movements from below. History is filled with examples of people fighting against exploitation. And one of our principal tasks as socialists is to support these movements to help make collective action a viable choice for even more people. In this effort and the struggle to define the values of a more just society, we will be aided, not hurt, by our shared nature.
So I think today we did some tabling in Frist as my guest, and we got a question about like how can socialism work if human nature is intrinsically evil and selfish? And that's a question that I think we get a lot, and not that I made it into this book.
Yeah.
But I think like while it seems like easy to believe that and hard to believe that people can be good. One of the things that ABCs of Socialism underscores is that like our shared nature, it can help us build and define values for a more just society, and that we can actually work together so that everybody can be fulfilled rather than be in competition with each other. The competition is not, it doesn't have to be made to be natural.
And another thing that I think is really important is that, like, the reason that so many people have this, like, image of socialism that's, like, in conflict with human nature is because so many, like, nations in the past that have called themselves socialist aren't really, or at least the type of socialism that we're trying to promote.
Yeah. And part of the democratic socialism is, in fact, the democratic parts, and that we don't believe in authoritarian socialism.
I mean, we have a discussion.
Yeah.
But you could see, I'm a socialist also, so I'm on our side, whatever. But you can also see people, groups of people who share fundamentally different kind of value, and that sometimes are opposed to other groups of people. And here, what I want to try to introduce is the notion of class. And so how does that square or doesn't square with human nature? Because the argument here is that, you know, there's no human nature, because people can be either good or bad, and it totally depends on the situation. So in a way, like, the argument says, like, we're all randomized, kind of, you know, we can act many differently, but at the same time, or in a way, there's no systematic behavior for most people. But on the other hand, we know, you know, that people like Trump and his friends have the systematic behavior that permits them to enrich themselves, and other people, like, you know, ordinary people, have other systematic behavior that, you know, help them cope with this exploitation or their survival. So how does that work with human nature? Or
what I think is, like, a really important distinction to make is that is human behavior and human nature. So even though, like, in our society that's, like, highly capitalistic, the way that people behave is influenced by that. Maybe, like, more so than their actual nature. So so people acting based on their class isn't in their nature. Is how I don't know.
I was wondering what people thought about the word hierarchy, no hierarchy.
No, I was just saying that.
Do you guys have copies of the ABCs of Socialism?
Nope.
Do you want a PDF?
Here we go.
Oh. Jamal, do you want a PDF?
Oh, I'm good.
So maybe one thing that you were pointing to is the fact that we have certain hierarchies in our society that are self-reinforcing, or the people who benefit from them reinforce them, being another way of saying that. So how do you see that playing out at Princeton specifically, given, like, how skewed the campus is toward, like, people who are benefiting from these structures, and, like, how have you, as someone who's, like, been organizing on campus, dealt with that? Because there's not a super amount of visibility for YDS on campus.
Yeah. I don't know how people can. I have, like, an example in mind.
I think that's a really good question to pose. And something that I've been thinking about too, I mean, I'm only a sophomore, but, like, having been here 2 years, I've really seen, I mean, I've started to see, like, the ways in which, like Princeton as an institution, like, doesn't necessarily align with the interests of, like, students. And I think something that I've come to, like, realize is that, like, being at Princeton, I shouldn't feel, like, bad for asking Princeton to, like, serve me in a sense, instead of like me always doing like what Princeton tells me to do. So one of my examples would be like, this is not YDS related specifically, but I've been involved with Native American Students Association, and one of the things that we've been working on is beginning Asian American Studies at Princeton, which has been a very, very long and arduous process of basically like administration not wanting to hire faculty because it's kind of like this forever like unending cycle of like, we won't give you faculty, so you can't have a department, but if you don't have a department, you can't have faculty, so you kind of get stuck in this loop. Yeah, I mean, I don't know how well this answers your question, but I mean, I definitely feel that, like, this presence of Princeton as an institution.
Yeah, well, the example that I was about to give was also not directly related to YDS, but in terms of, like, eating options at Princeton, there's this, like, huge presence of the eating clubs, right? And Princeton, too, is, like, like prospective students, that's what I was looking for, really likes to emphasize that the eating clubs are not part of the university. You don't have to join one if you don't want to. And yet, the university makes it really difficult to be not in an eating club or not on a meal plan. There's like one bus program on the weekends that goes out to the supermarkets. For independent students, there's the difference between the independent student housing in Spelman, which is the apartment style housing with a kitchen in every room, and the other independent student housing is like a kitchen in every room versus a kitchen in every like residential hall. So like one kitchen to four people versus maybe like 100 people. So definitely you see this like privileging or prioritizing of students who can afford to join eating clubs, because there's also a definite divide between like students in eating clubs and students who are not in eating clubs, because of like for like an economic divide and a racial divide, because students of color often like, well, you remember you were telling me about how like students of color are more represented in like students who are independents, because they like miss their home family's cooking. So the university definitely prioritizes like eating clubs, because these are like students who come from wealthier families who are contributing more to the university or will go on to contribute more to the university. So that's difficult.
So in terms of just like directing the conversation, who like are there people who need to be convinced of socialism, or are we like all like what is the situation there?
So personally, I don't need to be convinced, but I do have a question going back to the text. I agree that human nature doesn't make it impossible for us to be compassionate and to want to like engage in a socialist society. But at the end, it says that collective action requires different individuals to take these risks together. And personally, I think that, you know, risk aversion is also part of human nature. And since it seems that you need a critical mass to get to this point, I was wondering if anyone had any comments on like overcoming, so like which aspect of human nature is stronger, the compassion or the risk aversion, and how do you sort of lessen the risk for people? Is it through just more people joining the movement, or is it through like structures that have to be put in place, and who's going to put in those structures, and how is this ever going to like happen? You know, if there's been thought about that, or if anyone had any comments about that. This seems to be too equally strong, or maybe not, aspects of human nature in competition.
Well, I think a lot of this goes to the idea of solidarity, that to kind of strengthen the idea of solidarity, it does mitigate the risk for any individual, and it at the same time increases the chance that you're going to get a positive result. That if you're working and coordinating with a large number of people who share your interests and have common goals, that you know the danger of one person getting fired for a strike is much lessened if everyone they work with, and if there's no one else that can be brought in to scab for them.
Right. Then this like maybe you guys can tell us as organizers on campus, how is it that you spread your message also while overcoming that risk of being maybe ostracized or silenced, or maybe anyone else who has experience in the quote unquote real world, because I guess we're assuming that this is not the real world. But yeah.
I mean, kind of related. I think a big part of like looking forward in terms of moving in terms of solidarity and socialism is part of like the destigmatization of socialism, the word, because I think a lot of people are afraid of it. I've sat at the YDS table for a couple hours today, and just seeing reactions of people was really interesting. It seems like the older generation were more sort of interested and more accepting of socialism, while the sort of Reagan era in between was scoffing at us. Like, so it was very interesting to see that. And I think a big part of like what we're trying to do here and what we're going to try to do as a YDS chapter looking forward is to destigmatize the word and sort of talk about issues with other organizations on campus, Mashi, Dream Team, there are many others, in terms of our platform.
There have also been people asking us, like, a person of color is a face for the feminist movement, and I think one of the advantages of like democratic socialism is that we value we value looking at intersections of multiple systems of oppression. So to be fundamentally anti-racist and fundamentally anti-misogynist, that's part of this is one of the ways in which like we can address like this anxiety of like will we actually be accounted for like within this world.
Well, isn't that precisely the demographic that this movement is trying to help? Right? So that you need to reach out to people that are oppressed in order to remove a system that is oppressive, right? Those are the people that have to be included in the revolution or take the revolution to their own hands in a way. Because it is for them at the end of the day. They're the ones that are losing out.
I think, yes, there's this dimension of solidarity, but you know, there's a portrayal of division among people in society where we have different kind of oppression, which is true, and we have different problems. But that's not true. You know, the reason why you have a society where you have racism, sexism, all those different kind of separation between working class people is to weaken us all.
Yeah.
And so, and I think it's important for white, and for example, if you're member of social party, like for when you have white male comrades, to understand that it's not just you don't do that just because you want to help minority or women. You do that because you need the participation of minority and women to liberate even you. Mm. You don't know you're not liberated actually. And so I think that's also the socialism being like so much more exciting, because people would think they have it good, even white male. Don't understand how stifled we also are, and I'm not saying I'm not talking about I'm just saying that still women have oppressions that we don't face, but we have so much more to gain over from that.
I think more on a practical level as well, you're starting to see that different sort of movements that are kind of gained steam over recent years, such as, of course, Black Lives Matter, but also Fight for 15. I think kind of organizers are starting to realize that a lot of the kind of root causes of both of our problems and both of our oppression are similar. So you did see, like, between Fight for 15 and Black Lives Matter, you did see them come together and kind of issue statements of support and attend sort of each other's protests. So At least on the street level, I feel like that's important. I think one of the more militant unions in America, Unite Here, they came out big for sanctuary cities because they realized that a lot of their members have undocumented family members. So I think on, you know, people are starting to see each other, like, hey, you know, we're kind of on the same wavelength here.
Given like the status of the DSA overall as like a 501c4, right? What are like the goals, if because you can't endorse candidates outright, right? So what are like the goals, like politically in the short term?
Well, for YDS, I can speak for YDS, in that like the campus is really like lacking a like united left of center, any sort of like political student group. So like being that presence for the first time here is a big thing. And DSA is similar also in that it's a lot of different like people on the political spectrum coming together, like leftists on the political spectrum coming together. They have less of like a unified political ideology.
I'm going to say a quick word about the DSA has a political action committee which can and does endorse candidates.
For more than a year, the Black Lives Matter movement has gripped the United States. The movement's central slogan is a simple declarative recognition of black humanity in a society that is wracked by economic and social inequality that are disproportionately experienced by African Americans. The movement is relatively new, but the racism that spawned it is not. By every barometer in American society, healthcare, education, employment, poverty, African Americans are worse off. Elected officials from across the political spectrum often blame these disparities on an absence of, quote, personal responsibility, or view them as a cultural phenomenon particular to African Americans. In reality, racial inequality has been largely produced by government policy and private institutions that not only impoverish African Americans, but also demonize and criminalize them.
Yet racism is not simply a product of errant public policy or even the individual attitudes of racist white people. And understanding the roots of racism in American society is critical for eradicating it. Crafting better public policy and banning discriminatory behavior by individuals or institutions won't do the job. And while there is a serious need for government action banning practices that harm entire groups of people, these strategies fail to grasp the scale and depth of racial inequality in the United States, to understand why the United States seems so resistant to racial equality. We have to look beyond the actions of elected officials or even those who prosper from racial discrimination in the private sector. We have to look at the way American society is organized under capitalism.
Divide and rule. Capitalism is an
economic
system based on the exploitation of the many by the few. Because of the gross inequality it produces, capitalism relies on various political, social, and ideological tools to rationalize that inequality, while simultaneously dividing the majority, who have every interest in uniting to resist it. How does the 1% maintain its disproportionate control of the wealth and resources in American society? By a process of dividing rule.
racism is only one among many oppressions intended to serve this purpose. For example, American racism developed under the regime of slavery as justification for the enslavement of Africans at a time when the world was celebrating the concepts of liberty, freedom, and self-determination. The dehumanization and subjection of black people had to be rationalized in this moment of new political possibilities. But the central objective was preserving the institution of slavery and the enormous riches that it produced.
As Karl Marx recognized, direct slavery is just as much the pivot of bourgeois industry as machinery, credits, etc. Without slavery, you have no cotton. Without cotton, you have no modern industry. It is slavery that has given the colonies their value. It is the colonies that have created the world trade. And it is the world trade that is the precondition of large-scale industry. Thus, slavery is an economic category of the greatest importance. Marx also identified the centrality of African slave labor to the genesis of capitalism when he wrote that the discovery of gold and silver in America, the extirpation, enslavement, and entombment in mines of the Aboriginal population, the beginning of the conquest and looting of the East Indies, the turning of Africa into a warren for the commercial hunting of black skins, signalized the rosy dawn of the era of capitalist production.
The labor needs of capital alone could explain how racism functions under capitalism. The literal dehumanization of Africans for the sake of labor was used to justify their harsh treatment and their debased status in the United States. This dehumanization did not simply end when slavery was abolished. Instead, the mark of inferiority branded onto black skin carried over into emancipation and laid the basis for the second class citizenship African American experience for close to 100 years after slavery.
Pass.
Okay. The debasement of blacks also made African Americans more vulnerable to economic coercion and manipulation, not just anti-blackness. Coercion and manipulation were rooted in the evolving economic demands of capital, but their impact rippled far beyond the economic realm. Black people were stripped of their right to vote, subjected to wanton violence, and locked into menial and poorly paid labor. This was the political economy of American racism. There was another consequence of racism and the Marxian blacks. African Americans were so thoroughly banished from political, civil, and social life that it was virtually impossible for the vast majority of poor and working class whites to even conceive of uniting with blacks to challenge the rule and authority of the ruling white clique.
Marx recognized this basic division within the working class when he observed, "In the United States of America, every independent movement of the workers was paralyzed as long as slavery disfigured part of the republic. Labor cannot emancipate itself in the white skin where, in the black, it is branded." Marx grasped the modern dynamics of racism as the means by which workers who had common objective interests could also become mortal enemies because of subjective, but nevertheless real, racist and nationalist ideas. Looking at the tensions between the Irish and English workers, Marx wrote, "Every industrial and commercial center in England possesses a working class divided into two hostile camps, English proletarians and Irish proletarians. The ordinary English worker hates the Irish worker as a competitor who lowers his standard of life. In relation to the Irish worker, he feels himself a member of the ruling nation and so turns himself into the tool of the aristocrats and capitalists of his country against Ireland."
This antagonism is artificially kept alive and intensified by the press, the pulpit, the comic papers, in short, by all the means at the disposal of the ruling classes. This antagonism is the secret of the impotence of the English working class, despite its organization. It is the secret by which the capitalist maintains its power, and that class is fully aware of it. For socialists in the United States, recognizing the centrality of racism in dividing the class that has the actual power to undo capitalism, has typically meant that socialists have been heavily involved in campaigns in social movements and racism. But within the socialist tradition, many have also argued that because African Americans and most other non-whites are disproportionately poor and working class, campaigns aimed at ending economic inequality alone would stop their oppression. This stance ignores how racism constitutes its own basis for oppression for non-white people. Ordinary blacks and other non-white minorities are oppressed not only because of their poverty, but also because of their racial and ethnic identity.
Racism is
There is also no direct correlation between economic expansion or improved economic conditions and a decrease in racial inequality. In reality, racial discrimination often prevents African Americans and others from fully accessing the fruits of economic expansion. After all, the Black insurgency of the 1960s coincided with the robust and thriving economy of the 1960s. Black people were rebelling because they were locked out of American affluence. Looking at racism as only a byproduct of economic inequality ignores the ways that racism exists as an independent force that wreaks havoc in the lives of all African Americans.
The struggle against racism regularly intersects with struggles for economic equality, but racism does not only express itself over economic questions. Anti-racist struggles can also take place in response to the social crises Black communities experience, including struggles against racial profiling, police brutality, housing, healthcare, and educational inequality, and mass incarceration and other aspects of the criminal justice system. These fights against racial inequality are critical both to improving the lives of African Americans and other racial and ethnic minorities in the here and now, and to demonstrating to ordinary white people the destructive impact of racism in the lives of non-white people.
Winning ordinary whites to an anti-racist program is a key component in building a genuine unified mass movement capable of challenging capital. Unity cannot be achieved by suggesting that Black people should downplay the role of racism in our society so as not to alienate whites, while only focusing on the more important struggle against economic inequality.
This is why multiracial groupings of socialists have always participated in struggles against racism. This was particularly true throughout the 20th century, as African Americans became a more urban population in constant conflict and competition with native-born and immigrant whites over jobs, housing, and school. Violent conflict between working class Blacks and whites underlined the extent to which racial division destroyed the bonds of solidarity necessary to collectively challenge employers, landlords, and elected officials. Socialists played key roles in campaigns against lynching and racism in the criminal justice system, like the Scottsboro Boys campaign in the 1930s, when 9 African American youths were accused of raping 2 white women in Scottsboro, Alabama. The Liberal National Association for the Advancement of Colored people had been reluctant to take the case, but the Scottsboro trials became a priority for the Communist Party and its affiliated International Legal Defense.
One part of the campaign involved touring the mothers of the boys around the world and then around the country and then around the world to draw attention and support their case. I think she said Ida, but I don't know. German would be odd. I think she said Ida. Ada Wright, mother of 2 of the boys, traveled to 16 countries in 6 months in 1932 to tell her son's stories. Because she was traveling with known communists, she was barred from speaking. In Czechoslovakia, she was accused of being a communist and jailed for 3 days before being expelled from the country.
Socialists were also involved in unionization drives among African Americans and were central to civil rights campaigns in the North, South, and West for African Americans and other oppressed minorities. This engagement explains why many African Americans gravitated towards socialist politics over the course of their lives. Socialists have always articulated a vision of society that could guarantee genuine Black freedom. By the late 1960s, even figures like Martin Luther King Jr. were describing a kind of socialist vision of the future. In a 1966 presentation to a gathering of his organization, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, King commented,
"We must honestly face the fact that the movement must address itself to the question of restructuring the whole American society. There are 40 million poor people here. And one day we must ask the question, why are there 40 million poor people in America? And when you begin to ask that question, you are raising questions about the economic system, about a broader distribution of wealth. When you ask that question, you begin to question the capitalist economy.
Who owns the oil? You begin to ask the question, who owns the iron ore? You begin to ask the question, why is it that people have to pay water bills in a world that is 2/3 water? These are questions that must be asked. As movements continue to radicalize, groups like the Black Panthers and the League of Revolutionary Black Workers followed in the tradition of Malcolm X when they linked Black oppression directly to capitalism. The Panthers and the League went further than Malcolm by attempting to build socialist organizations for the specific purpose of organizing working class blacks to fight for a socialist future. Today, the challenge for socialists is no different. Being centrally involved in struggles against racism while also fighting for a world based on human need, not profit.
A year ago already, black student, black woman, organized a, the Progressing is a Racist campaign, and we're changing the name. I think, you know, we should have, like, as socialists, we should totally, like, you know, put a statement of support and help publicize that throughout the campus. That's, for me, that's like one example of how you can, it's okay. I mean, if people who are already oppressed initiate their own struggle, it's okay to come and in support, and also look for, you know, commonality between, and political commonality between the two groups, and both can gain, you know, on the struggle. And I think there were some reforms, you could say, that were passed in the university about the reason, but did we win the fight? I don't know.
I've been thinking about that too, the Woodrow Wilson, like the refusal of the administration to change Woodrow Wilson. Kind of what I was saying earlier about this idea of like, as students, like we're here at this institution, but in a way, like there isn't anything wrong with asking the institution to serve us in a way. And like the Woodrow Wilson building is mostly occupied by students, and this is the building that like students go into like all the time, and like, these are where students like do work, and that there is something inherently unjust and anti-socialist about not being able to like ask for a name change and have that fulfilled when that's like, kind of like, what the student population wants. That's great.
In that section we just read, I was struck. I was already thinking about like, you know, what I'm like curious what socialism means to you all, and how you conceptualize socialism. Earlier on, I heard it referred to as like a revolution and as a party. And then I was struck in this section, it's really good. I remember it as talking about socialism as a struggle. And then the conversation we're having right now, it strikes me that it's a good kind of ethic of when stuff comes up. Socialism is this kind of body of knowledge you can draw on to say, okay, now, you know, what's the proper way to go about this protest? How do you make it so that this isn't like an empty victory, an empty word of a victory? And so getting back to this reading and thinking about socialism as a struggle, it strikes me that, you know, socialism isn't only the end, it's also the path that you go about doing it. And so, I'm just curious, why not rename the building yourself? Like, why accept the authority of the university to name the, I guess it's the Robertson Hall, but the Woodrow Wilson School. Like, why doesn't the socialist community rename? And I think it's, I personally, I think it's a stupid idea to name buildings after people. But like, I mean, just to pick up to say, seriously, but like, why not just call it the Debs Building? And then it's the Debs Building. And then press the university. The reason I thought of that is because at Yale, there was a similar issue about Calhoun College. And there, one of the big pivot points was when the students just, I don't think we should call it the Debs Building. The students, they kind of like thinking about, again, that old musician Prince, who's at one point he became known as the artist formerly known as Prince. And so kind of whimsically, the students called Calhoun College, college formerly known as Calhoun, and whatever that acronym became. And once the students stopped giving over that hegemony to the university and stopped letting the university say, this is Calhoun College, but that was a real pivot point toward then the university not changing the name, I would argue, but acknowledging that the college's name had been changed just by people. And so thinking about socialism as a pathway, you know, why just make pleas and grievances to the university? I think it's important to also think about yourselves as people with your own agency and just make the change that you want, and then try and, you know, see that the university all of a sudden coming away.
Yeah, I think that's a fantastic idea, and it really could work. But Princeton, as the university, as the institution that it is, this historic, prestigious university, really does, like, you don't have a sense of ownership of the place coming through here, right? It's has so much history, and that history is thrown at you. Say, like, you are part of this university. Like, this university is not part of you. You have no right to change it because it's been this way for hundreds and hundreds of years, and this has to do also with, like, chalk protests are not allowed, and protests, like, you're not allowed to put protest banners or, like, structures that people who are coming to visit the university might see, because that tarnishes the image of the university. And so a lot of students, yeah, there's no sense of ownership. And I think doing something, like you said, would really change not only with the Woodrow Wilson School's name, but also it could blow over into other aspects of the ways that we as students engage with this institution.
Yeah, well, you said that there was some of the this generation,
Me?
Yeah.
Francois.
Francois said earlier about, like, a socialist vision emancipates everyone. And so, like, it was what you're saying, sort of, when people are showing up and kind of get shell-shocked by this kind of atmosphere that's very thick and, like, trying to get you to just be most similar to what you said earlier, like, where you don't have a voice, but you're just, like, supposed to kind of do what, you know, this kind of intangible custom is expecting you to do. And so I think that's why acts like what I'm saying are important, is because it cracks it open for all of us. And we say, oh yeah, we don't need to accept this as a name. And then Christmas is Yale's got you covered when it comes to, like,
yeah, and all these institutions.
That's part of what was so shocking to the students, was that, like, oh yeah, we don't need to just accept this.
Yeah.
Yeah. So,
okay.
Last year, at the BJL protest, like, I don't know, I think it was like 13-something students, like, slept in Nassau Hall overnight, and at one point administrators came in and told them, if you keep doing this, you're going to get expelled. The administrators had, like, no right to expel students for protesting, for sleeping in a university, but, like, we live at this university, you know, it affects us. So administrators, like, straight up lied to these students. But, like, you can't expel 13 students for protesting, you know? So there's this, like, inherent fear of the institution that needs to be overcome for this type of resistance.
I also wanted to say, this is sort of off topic from what we're talking about currently, but going back to what you said about eating options and how minority students are, like, overwhelmingly independent, that is something that isn't known. And I know there's an initiative now for, like, eating clubs to release demographic information, and there's a huge debate about how that could be, like, misconstrued, or I don't know, I don't want to get into that right now, but I know that at least having those logistics out there for both eating clubs and independent students would do away with this atomization of campus that, like, had different racial groups have, and also different social groups and class groups, and maybe, like, having to do with what you study or whatever, when you realize that, like, across varying demographics, there are people who feel, I guess, oppressed would be the word. And yeah, that also goes back to sort of intersectionality in So that's like a practical application of that to Vincent's current situation.
I mean, to what you were saying about atomization, I think something that I feel is very strong here at Princeton is the tendency to rally around race, but to put a stigma around conversations about class. And so I've had multiple conversations with like very progressive people that surprise me when they are upset by bringing in discussions of class into discussions of race. And I don't really have like an answer, but I feel like it's much stronger here than in other places. And so like to think about like how you have a conversation about how you bring in socialism into a conversation with people who have had to develop very strong identities around race because of the like historical whiteness here.
I think it's a very important point, and I don't know, as a socialist from experience and recent experience, you can say that class trumps race. And in a way, so let me explain. You look at the, you know, race or even sexes. You look at who was president before Trump. It was, you know, an African American, and there were a lot of expectation, enormous amount of expectation from the black community, and that's why they a lot of them vote for him, about, you know, actually changing, really making a difference, a strong difference in their lives. And now, you know, 8 years later, there's not as much enthusiasm to vote for, you know, the candidate of the same party, a woman. And I think, you know, this question of like, what kind of lesson do we learn from having elected actually African American with highest sphere of power benefited actually the African American community? Like, this question is very important, I think, to grapple with as socialists. And you can use the answer to that. I mean, I don't assume that anybody is convinced one way or another. But for me, I'm convinced that, you know, it's not by electing a person based on their ethnicity, on their sex, on their race, on their sexual orientation, that you're actually going to fight against those oppression. It's electing somebody who has a political program about it, and it doesn't matter whatever, you know, class, I mean, affiliation, whatever they are. What matters is the political program of the person you're fighting, you're rooting for. And in the United States, there's a lot of like apoliticization. I don't know if you can say this, electoral race. And what in the media, what people are looking for is like, oh, you know, is this person, you know, a good father, or, you know, like very completely apolitical, depoliticizing as much as possible the candidates in order to remove actually politics, remove, you know, having, so that it helps candidates to not show a real program for, you know, a real political program. So I'm sorry, I'm going a bit too long here, but.
Just as a timekeeper, we do have to leave this room in a couple minutes. There's a talk at 5:30. There are spaces that we can go to continue talking if anyone wants to, but just let the speakers wrap up if they want. It's 23:05.
Thank you all for coming and having me over to conversation and meeting with us. We will be sticking around, Tess and I, so you can come and talk to us. I really enjoyed hearing what everybody had to say. If you are a Princeton student or if you live in the community, you can go ahead and talk to Tess about joining our list serve.
For joining one of the guests. We'll also be at the table downstairs. We're like by the mailboxes in the 100 level.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.